Welcome, welcome, welcome. In the previous video, we started the valve adjustment, but I ran out of a couple shim sizes. So while waiting for those, I pulled the thermoset housing tappet for the turbo water drain port. I use the same drill bit and tap kit as for the turbo boost reference fitting here. Since I am using a dual ball bearing turbo, it has ports to cool down the turbo using both water and oil to help prolong its life. Most turbos are journal bearing and only have ports for oil. So ball bearing turbos have been proven to perform better than journal bearing, and you have added cooling capabilities with that. So that was a no-brainer for me. Once the fitting was installed, I installed the T-fitting on my existing temperature sensor housing so that I could add the turbo water feed fitting. Since I originally used Teflon tape, I had to clean up the residue and prep the area for the liquid thread sealant to bond to the surface properly. You may find that the sealant still has gooey consistency after a few days, and that's normal. Most of the liquid thread sealants will fully cure after high temperatures applied, so once we have the car back up and running, the hot water should help cure it. It's recommended that you replace the O-rings for the pipes connecting into the thermoset housing if you haven't done it in a while. I had recently replaced mine, so I didn't bother this time. Another common failure piece on the S54 is the factory water pump, since the impeller is made of plastic and it breaks down over time, then causing overheating issues. If you haven't replaced it already with an upgraded metal impeller unit, you should definitely do that since you're already in there. Make it easier for you. For those that are interested, I'll drop a link in the description for the updated model. The GoPro died as I was torquing down the bolts, and then I decided to continue the next day. I was able to go and get the remaining shims I was missing from the motorcycle parts store and worked on installing those and then replacing the valve cover gaskets. It's important to make sure that the areas where the gaskets touch on both the valve cover and the head are clean and free from any residue from older gaskets, so make sure to clean those. I don't show it here because I had recently pulled the motor and done that already. You can use a small blade or a Scotch-Brite to get some of the tougher spots, just make sure not to drop any Scotch-Brite residue inside the head. Before putting the big valve cover gasket, you should add a little bit of gray RTV sealant at the top of the cracks here, between the vanos housing and the head, since there's a slight gap that could introduce some leaks later on. Once the gaskets are all in place, you need to follow the torque sequence to ensure the valve cover is torqued evenly on the head. So, I used this picture from FCP Euro. valve cover reinstalled and torqued, I removed the front stud previously used for the plastic cover that goes on top of the valve cover, since I won't be using that with the turbo in the way. Since we're going to be adding a lot more power to the ignition system, this will also help in cooling down the ignition coils at the top, because they get hot with that cover anyway. Once the stud was off, I reinstalled the coils and their wiring harness, and then moved on to removing the factory oil temperature sensor so that I could install the T adapter that will allow me to feed oil to the turbo. Make sure you replace the copper crush washer that was on the sensor and put it on the male end of the adapter, since that's what's going to screw into the oil filter housing now. Tighten it until the top female port points up, and then install the sensor in the rear port and tighten that. Now it's time to install the oil feed line, so I put some thread seal on there before tightening it down. Once I was done with the oil feed line, I started taking off the idle control valve hoses to measure them and replace them. Now these hoses will crack over time, and although this isn't a problem when you're naturally aspirated, since there isn't much pressure in the intake manifold then, it's a huge problem when you're introducing boost, since it could leak the air pressure generated by the turbo through those cracks. This then results in power loss because the engine isn't receiving the pressure it's supposed to. Now, you'll notice the smallest hose that connects to the idle control valve goes back to towards the fuel tank, and since we don't want that to be pressurized, I'll be installing a check valve to ensure air only goes from the tank to the intake manifold and not the other way around, since that could cause issues. Unfortunately, direct replacement hoses cost an arm and a leg. When I was looking into this, I think it's about $60 for each of the three hoses from BMW, which is expensive. So I decided to replace the hoses using high pressure hoses from AutoZone. Now, the big problem is that the sizes used from the factory are rare, and some parts of the hoses are actually larger than others, which made it extremely hard to install, let alone find a hose size that worked. I believe the factory hoses are primarily 13/16 of an inch inner diameter hoses, but no one sells those, so I decided to go with a 3/4 inch hose instead, which is slightly smaller, but with a lot of elbow grease and some tricks like spraying brake cleaner inside the hose to slide it on, I was able to make it all work in the end. I just found out that Rogue Engineering makes silicone replacement hoses at about $120 all in, as opposed to $200 for the 3 OEM hoses, so I would definitely recommend this option if you can spare the funds and don't want the headache. You can see here I tried the warm water trick, where you leave the end of the hose in warm water for a few hours so that it could relax the rubber, but it didn't work, so I moved on to trying the trick I mentioned, where you spray the brake cleaner inside the hose and then push it onto the idle control valve, and that was what ultimately worked in my case. I eventually pulled off the idle control valve unit to make my life easier as well. There's one hose that I didn't show as complete in this video because I needed the new intake manifold to determine how much length I needed to cut, so I'll cover that in the video where I install the intake manifold. The cxracing manifold does not have the same quick connect flange that the factory manifold does, so I cut off the little tabs on the 90 degree plastic elbow that comes on the idle control valve, so I could fit a small length of hose over it to later connect it to the new manifold, but securely. When I pulled the old hoses off, they left a lot of rubber residue, so I used the razor blade and wire wheel Dremel bit to cut it all off. Okay, here's one of the more difficult parts of this whole build, drilling a hole in your oil pan for the turbo oil drain line. Now, to take a step back and explain what this oil line will be used for, basically, the oil from the engine will be sent into the turbo from that feed line I set up earlier, and then that will help cool down the turbo during operation. Since the turbo gets extremely hot, the oil fed through it will also heat up quite a bit, so it needs to be recycled with new oil while the car is running. This is where the drain line comes in. You're essentially dumping hot oil into the oil pan so it can go back into the engine, and then eventually get cooled through oil cooler and whatnot. Then, as the oil leaves through the drain pour, more oil is fed through the feed line to replace that. Since this car didn't come with the turbo from the factory and there's no good pour on the exhaust side to reuse for the drain, I had to drill a hole into the oil pan, which is very common on turbo installs for previously naturally aspirated engines. You need to be extremely careful when picking a spot to drill in the pan, since you want it to be as high as possible, but not so high that you end up drilling into some of the built-in baffling on the S54 pan. The spot I picked ended up being perfect, so feel free to use mine as guidance. The reason you need the hole to be as high as possible is so it can sit above the highest point the oil gets to while the end's running, so that way you don't have the oil going back up the drain line. You'll notice that I'm doing this with the oil pan still attached to the engine. If you're pulling the pan to do rod bearings or pistons, it's much easier that way. You just pull the pan, drill the hole while it's outside of the car. But since I've already done those, I decided to do it this way. It's definitely a lot harder, but it's fine so long as you have a method to catch the metal shavings that will get thrown around, since you definitely don't want to destroy your engine by having those sucked into it. I happen to have a shop vac with a thin attachment that allowed me to pretty much put it into the oil pan and have it suck everything up. When I was done drilling everything, I kept vacuuming around in there just to make sure there weren't any shavings that could have fallen. There are plenty of methods out there for drilling the oil pan still attached to the car, but this worked best for me. Some people use grease, you know, I've seen some other ways, but you know, this is an extremely intimidating process, so if you don't feel comfortable doing it this way, I would say just pull the pan. Worst thing you'll need to do is clean the contact areas between the block and the pan and then reapply sealant. It's not a big deal. The CX Racing kit comes with this style plug, which requires a nut on the inside of the pan. This type is a pain in the ass, but I wouldn't recommend it. What I would use instead is one of these NPT thread ones so that you don't have to worry about getting a wrench on the inside, and it'll definitely seal great. The hose is a 10AN, so that's what you should use when picking a size for both the hose and that NPT plug, if you're gonna go that route. I've included a link for both the hose I used and the NPT style plug that you can use if you wanted to go that route. I forgot to point out that I took out the pickup tube filter plate to get access into the oil pan from below. This is pretty much the best way to get this all done without pulling the pan, so that's what I'd used. If yours is leaking oil, make sure to replace that little gasket, as it's a cheap part to stop the leak. Yes, in the next episode, the engine goes out. I was definitely not looking forward to this. Honestly, it didn't take that long since I've already done it a couple times before, so I probably took it out in about 30 minutes or so. I already had most of the stuff I needed unplugged, so made it easy. But that is it for this video. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you guys in the next one.